The gospel lesson is taken from the 23rd chapter of the Gospel of Luke, beginning at verse 33. Listen to and for the word of God. When they came to the place that is called the skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of one condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." This is the word of the Lord. It's been almost 2 weeks since the election of Donald J. Trump as president-elect of the United States of America. Feelings of euphoria and despair fill the human spirit. We have serious work to do as citizens and a country. Disregard for authority in a variety of forms dominates American culture and life. Yet Christ the King Sunday insists we come to terms with authority. Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Christians are called out to be different. We have a calling, people. For such a time as this, rise up, church. For more than 1,600 years, Christianity provided a compelling vision for human identity, purpose, and ethics. Christians demonstrate a quality of life which was different. The church was recognized as a shaper of societal beliefs, values, attitudes, and behaviors. Christians believed that all things had begun within God, whose internal life as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit was relationship in its very essence. Made in God's image, the Imago Dei, human beings were to live a transparent and loving relationship with God and one another, and a creative and respectful relationship with the earth and its creatures that inhabited it. You see, Christians in those first 1,600 years lived differently than others. Their beliefs informed their behaviors. But on the dawn of the 1600s, the 17th century, as the Reformation was taking hold, the cultural receptivity to the church and to the gospel began to break up. Now, that didn't start in the 1970s, the cultural receptivity to the church. Started at the dawn of the 17th century, the church had become corrupt. It was dividing rapidly into what would soon become many denominations. Political and religious authority was breaking down. The printing press emerged. Sudden advances in scientific understanding were laying bare the mechanics of how the universe worked. Human sense of self-sufficiency radically increased. John Archibald Wheeler was a theoretical physicist and colleague of Albert Einstein. The man who coined the term black hole Wheeler was possessed by the search for a unified theory of reality. Quote, "To my mind, there must be at the bottom of it all not an equation, but an utterly simple idea. And to me, that idea, when we finally discover it, will be so compelling, so inevitable, that we will say to one another, oh, how beautiful, how could it have been otherwise?" Well, Christians can live the simple idea because of what Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, accomplished. With Paul in the text from Colossians, we hold the belief that God was pleased to have his fullness dwell in him, Jesus, and through him, Jesus, to reconcile himself to all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Oh, this simple idea of all things being reconciled in Jesus Christ is at the core of reality. I don't think Wheeler was thinking of faith in Jesus Christ, but Wheeler was thinking about an idea that would coalesce and be so simple it would bring things together. Do you believe at such a time as this, the world needs to see a reconciling as opposed to division? We're encountered and transformed by God, whom we meet in Jesus Christ. Michael Horton writes, "Christ's kingdom is already here, but it's not yet consummated. Christ came the first time in humility and self-sacrifice to bring salvation. The second time he's coming in power and glory to judge." So yes, as Luke so faithfully records, Jesus saved others and resisted the temptation to save himself that day at the place called the skull. You see, I think our society is confused on who the King of Kings is. It won't last long, the euphoria over Mr. Trump. And it wouldn't have lasted long over the euphoria of Mrs. Clinton. The euphoria doesn't last long for new pastors. The euphoria doesn't last long for any human leader, because no human leader is King of Kings. America is not going to be saved by who we elect in 2016 or who we elect in 2020 or 24 or 28. No human leader can be King of Kings. This Christ the King Sunday, we need to come to terms with displaced loyalty. God says we need to respect the authority of our leaders. We must come to terms with that and not think that we as humans can base all authority in ourselves and think we truly know best. Oh, this Christ the King Sunday, it's important for us to remember the words read from Psalm 46. In God is our refuge and strength. And the words from Jeremiah, that was a strong warning for shepherds who scatter their flock. Oh, that's a word to pastors who lead in their own power with their own interest and not the flock's in mind. Oh, it's a word to leaders in general. On Christ the King Sunday, there's only one leader. Paul tells us in Colossians, it's Jesus Christ, in whom all things are reconciled from beginning to end. This is where our loyalty should be, my friends. I'll be calling a friend of mine, Mike Pompeo. He and his wife Susan are members of Eastminster Presbyterian Church in Wichita. He will be nominated as the next director of the CIA. He's a smart guy, and he loves Jesus. My first thing is, what is possessing you to take on that? But we need to respect authority. For such a time as this, I'll remind Mike that Christ is king, not the CIA. Christ is king, not whoever's in the White House. Christ is king, not that city council member, or that mayor, or that legislator, or that pastor. Christ is king. So we have a calling to live, one which speaks into a culture which is self-absorbed. I cannot say that strong enough. Our culture is self-absorbed and leads with no regard for authority. Our voice calling for justice, which is our calling. Like in the day of Jeremiah, the power of God will be seen in shaping the playing out of human events. We're called to love and reject triumphalism and defeatism. We are to offer a witness of God's unconditional love in Jesus Christ. We're to love our neighbors. And those neighbors, my friends, are most likely not like ourselves. Again, Michael Horton writes, we are passive receivers of the gift of salvation, but are thereby made active worshipers in a life of thanksgiving that is exhibited chiefly in loving service to our neighbors. So let's get to work, church. We need God and each other, and we are only strong as the children of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.